Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on Local Gov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments. Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
17th, 2018, 7 p.m. Meeting of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners. We are all present, so Mr. Sutton, if you would please lead us with the invocation and the Pledge of Allegiance.
Thank you. I printed it off this time so my iPad wouldn't go off on me. And I'm going to have a moment of silence, which I don't think I've ever done here in all the years I've been here, to reflect on what has just taken place in our state, two states, over the last 4 or 5 days. But, you know, philosophically or theologically or whatever, you could sit back and say, why? Why can't things be stopped? Are things being forced? Are they being pushed? Whatever. And I'm not qualified to say, obviously. But Billy Graham's association did put out several years ago, and the title of it was, Where is God in Natural Disasters? And it gets into talking about the role, theologically, of a possible supernatural being or supreme, whatever. Why are things being allowed to happen? Why aren't things stopped or whatever? And I don't think it's up to us to question. But it is clear that from everything that you see, it is biblical that there are things that mankind, whether this was or not, but there are things that mankind is going to have to pay for to a degree based on disobedience or lack of respect or possible lack of dedication. And so the only thing I can say is there's a Bible verse that's been a lot to me over the years, and actually I ran it in my first ad is when I ran for commissioner years ago. 2 Chronicles 7:13-14, and if I may read it, it says, When I shut up the heavens so that there is no rain, or command the locust to devour the land, or send pestilence among my people, if my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive them and heal their land. And whether any of this is linked or not, I would just say those words and many other words that are in the Bible that address these issues of not adhering to the principles in the Bible, that mankind will pay a price. Whether that was part of it or not, I don't know. But I would ask us to have a moment of silence in thoughts of all the people that are paying one heck of a price for what has happened in North and South Carolina and elsewhere. And also definitely give thanks for the fact that we were not as affected as many others, thousands, hundreds of thousands were. If we could just have a moment of silence, please. Amen. We address the flag, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Excuse me. Okay, tonight we have no public speakers who have signed up to address the board. I would take this opportunity to ask the public, if you are watching this on video or at home, if you would, and you're thinking about coming to address the board, you have something on your mind and want to come be a public speaker, please look at our website, and we have the advice for public speakers on there. Also, we have rules of decorum in our rules of procedure for the board. So if you take a look at those before you come, that would be appreciated. So next on our agenda is approval of the agenda. If all of us have had a chance to review the agenda, if I could have a motion to approve it.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion and a second for approval of the agenda. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Next is the consent agenda. If everybody has had an opportunity to review that, if I could have a motion for approval of the consent agenda.
I move approval of the consent agenda.
Second.
We have a motion and a second for approval of the consent agenda. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you. Next on our agenda is a public hearing about economic incentives for Universal Preserve Akim. And Mac Williams, I think you're going to tell us about that.
So the representatives from UPI are not with us this evening. The commissioners can continue forward with this item or postpone it until the October 1st meeting, which I think would probably be appropriate. But the City Council of Levin has delayed their decision on UPI also. But it's the board's option. I would recommend that you consider postponing this until October 1.
I'll move that we postpone it October 1.
Is that this morning meeting?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Does that suit Mac? All right.
It suits me. It suits them.
All right.
Okay. And that was a weather-related problem, right? They couldn't get here because the air travel was disrupted because of the storm. Okay. So do we have a motion to table that until October 1st?
Bill made it, not seconded.
Okay, yep. Great. So we have a motion and a second. Is there any more discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? So we will do that October 1st. Next on the agenda is Lotus Bakeries, economic incentives for them. And this is a public hearing. So Mac, if you would, I guess, do us a presentation about what the thing's about, then we'll open the public hearing.
Thank you very much, Madam Chairman and Commissioners. I'm Mac Williams. I'm President of the Alamance Chamber. My pleasure tonight to introduce to you representatives for Lotus Bakeries. Who will provide the information about the project and answer any questions you may have, the public may have, about the project. Representing the company is Bart Vanderwegen, who is the person from Belgium, from Belgium who's going to be managing the facility. Also with him are his bride and two lovely children whom I just met this evening, so we welcome them to the proceedings. In addition, accompanying Bart are the consultants with the project, with CBRE, Aaron Herschel, and Alex Fry. And so we're delighted to have all of them here. I'm simply going to turn it over to Bart, who has a PowerPoint presentation to go through. And after that, the floor is yours and the public's to ask any questions you might have. So Bart, welcome.
Welcome. Mm-hmm. We're glad you're here.
Welcome back.
Thank you. Thanks for having me again. I'm a bit more nervous than previous time with my three main critics in the country now that have moved here since, but we'll make the best of it. I'll try to keep it short enough that we have enough time for discussion and questions afterwards, but nevertheless, I think it will be useful to reintroduce ourselves and also to make you aware where the change in investment has been laying and also where the potential new investment is kicking in. Because we've learned that from last week's hearing at Mebane City that there was a bit of confusion for the council members and how far it was a new investment and a change in investment, and it's a bit a mixture of both. And I'll try to clarify that first time right this time. So I'm going to introduce you again to the company and try to give you the feeling why Alamance County and Mebane are such a great fit for Lotus and Lotus a fit for you all. I'm going to give you a presentation on where the project is standing today, because 2 years ago it was all plans and sometimes even vague plans. Now we already have some pictures to show for it. And then I'm going to talk about those new investments and those changed investments for which we seek additional incentives. So our company, I think this is the slide that I can show you that represents the best what Lotus stands for. We try every day to be great at little things. And you see it's also a picture with a kid, because those little Biscoff cookies and all the other cookies and pastries, and since we've been here last time, a lot of natural foods, so dried fruits and date bars and things like that, that we're also putting in the market, that's the main driver still at Lotus, is being great at those little things. Because I think one of the things that makes Lotus what it is that it's a family-owned company founded in 1932, so over 80 years that we've been in business. And I mean, we're still family-owned. Our CEO is still a third-generation family member of the Boone family, Boone as we would say it here. And you feel that. That's what he's pushing us towards, to deliver that great taste, that great quality every day, and having all our customers enjoying our product worldwide. And I think of that particular Biscoff cookie, we make over 7 billion a year, and every year growing between 15 and 20%, so that's what we're aiming for. So as a further presentation of the company, we have our executive committee that has changed in one position since I was here last time. Mike Cuvelier, our CFO, is new, so Jan Boon is still CEO, family member. Isabel Maas at that time was CFO, and in that role she was project sponsor for this project, but she will remain to be, but she has changed over to CEO Natural Foods. I think since then we bought 3 or 4 companies that were selling natural snacks, so that's a full-blown business for us as well, and we try to keep both separated, the Lotus business and the natural foods business. Then we have Ignace Heyman, our CEO, in charge of the different areas, and in that role also the main leader, I would say, the main officer for area US, and then William Dupre, who is in charge of all our corporate services. As I have shown, and I think some areas have changed a bit, the white parts, the white countries there need further development as far as Lotus is concerned. That means that you can't buy our delicious products yet in those markets. The gray ones are where we are sold through distributors, and the red ones are where we have our own sales offices. And actually it's a presentation status at the 1st of January. South Africa is gonna become colored as well, because we're working at a natural foods manufacturing plant over there as well, where they get the fruits, immediately process them. This is our management team for the area North America. So Michelle Singer as our general manager, Christian Tesoro, he's new as well as sales director, and Michiel Bloemen is actually a new director of finance and supply chain as well. So, and then next year that team will be completed with myself in the role of operations director. Our numbers, 2 years ago I had the numbers of 15. At that point I was very proud, and I was announcing that I hoped that we would reach the number of half a billion euros in turnover. We realized that through takeovers from one side, on the other side, to volume growth and sales growth. So, and at the end of last year we had 524,000. 524 million euros, sorry, in turnover, and halfway through the year it looks good this year that we will do better next year. As far as our headcount goes, at that point it was a bit south of 1,500 people, about 50-50 as far as male versus female employees go, and with the hires that we will do still this year in Mabon, we will go over 1,500 people. Bringing back our international products in mind, and mainly because those are also the products that are big, or will hopefully become big in the US, so what you all know and what it's all about, you know, neat and pointing towards such a TV, is the top one, the Biscoff cookie that we will be making in Mabon, the bottom jar, the cookie butter that is quite popular in the US already. And then new products that you will see more and more in the coming months, and I think in most change it starts in October, is the dinosaur cookie, which is more a kid's proposal, and the yo-yo, this is our dried fruit line that we are launching. That is already at quite some Starbucks and others, but a lot of retailers will be added to that soon. I want to touch briefly on the pillars of our strategy, because it's also the best way to show what your company is all about. The first thing is the delicious, high-quality product. And That's clearly shown in this project, let me be honest with you. Since when we were standing here first time, we thought it was all about cost reduction and less cost for transportation and being over here. We still have that reduction in costs of transportation. What we have learned is that the raw materials are a lot more expensive over here than in Europe. Quite some protectionism on the sugar, for example, which really weighs on our cost of product. Nevertheless, our board clearly wanted to go through with this project because they believe in this quality advantage that we will have towards the customer. Being closer to our customers, meaning that the product can be 6 to 10 weeks fresher when you buy it, which will give us a huge qualitative advantage. And also having the opportunity in the plant to react quicker to demands of our customers. Strong focus on the best performing products, I think that is quite in line with it, and that's also that clear strategy to invest in our star product, the Biscoff, the cookie butter, the dinosaur, and have a clear focus on that, and that gives the company the breathing room to see in markets a bit at a time how smaller products may work and give them the time to grow. Communication with the customer. We recently added an action in the US through social media where people could send a picture of their moment of consumption of the Biscoff cookie, or more like an art-like picture. And I think the top three won basically an all-inclusive travel to Belgium to visit our headquarters to see where the product is coming from. And we're trying to do more and more of that, creating that direct connection with our customers, who's it all about. Targeted product innovations also there, you will see, and that's so typically for a well-led family-owned company. We try to be innovative, do the right things there. On the other hand, not too much. You won't see 100 flavors of Biscoff because we know what really works, we know what our customers are used to, and that's also what you will see in this project, that we will try to keep that same quality, that same great taste of our Biscoff cookie here in the US. Continuously improving our manufacturing efficiency. This plant should become the latest example of it, or should be the flagship as far as that type of innovation goes, as we have the opportunity to start up a greenfield plant that should be state of the art. And then our continuous commitment to corporate social responsibility. So as said, one of the things was quality, but also if we can reduce on transportation, basically taking care of the environment, but also things like sponsoring things like the Special Olympics, things like that, all different kind of projects where we try to give back to the communities that we're present in. So for our production efficiency, I couldn't leave this slide out because it was the first time that I saw it so nicely on a corporate slide, where we saw our United States new production facility in Mebane, North Carolina. So I thought that was a nice one to bring here today. And then again, our four pillars in our Care for Today, Respect for Tomorrow program, because that's one of the programs that I'm personally feeling really connected to and that I'm really proud of, that it's not a company that is just only about the revenue, about making profit. It is doing it in a sustainable way while not forgetting our neighbors, our people that work for us, our customers. So I think that's something I really like about this company. The project itself. 2 years ago it was just me with some support left and right, of course, for a project of this magnitude that wasn't adequate at all. On the left you have Johan Willems. He was at that time our financial director for the US. He has stepped down for that function to join the project leadership team full time. In the middle is Els van Parijs. She was our corporate director of R&D, also stepped down for that role to join this project. This only shows how involved everybody in the company is and how important this project is. Both of them, Els is still residing in Belgium, is over here about 50% of her time. Johan is still residing in San Francisco, but is also around here about 50% of his time. Baseline of our project, same great taste and texture that we want to get here. For the people of the press, this is totally off the record, but I'm aiming for a better taste and texture, but my bosses don't like to hear that, so let's keep that off the record. Packaging formats that we will start with is our, the top one is the two P-packs that you mainly know probably from the airlines, so what you have on Delta Airlines, American Airlines, Alaskan Airlines. And then the retail pack that you start seeing everywhere in retail, with Target, Kroger and Walmart as big drivers that allowed us to realize in the first 6 months a double-digit growth in volume in comparison to last year. And then we have those packed in a 1 kg box, so 4 packs of those, which do 2 rotations a year in Costco promotions. Workforce, it's an updated one. We're still talking about 60 people at startup. We're still remaining calm and looking to do things right one step at a time. The terms or the nomenclature may have changed in comparison. Now it's because we really designed those functions. We know who we're looking for. Actually, the technical and safety manager has been hired, is on board, couldn't be here tonight. I'm seeing people for the role of materials manager, plant controller, and HR business partner at this time. So it starts to, the ball is rolling there, and then more the production workers we will be hiring, first ones I think in December, and then the rest of them in the period January through April.
Can I ask you a question, please, if you don't mind me interrupting?
Of course.
Because I'm going to have to come back to it. From Doughmaker down, mm-hmm. bakers, packaging, warehouse workers and cleaning. What percentage of those of the 60 are temporary employees, or are they full time, or?
We're aiming at full time. Yes.
But what are they?
The percentage temporary would be zero, unless I can't at startup immediately fill it in. Then I will have to go to temporary. But there's no plans for temporary, because with the double digit growth, I will basically have to get my 2 lines that I have now. As soon as possible into 3 shifts. So we will do it 1 step at a time, day shift, 2 shifts, 3 shifts. But the idea is to have 3 shifts by the end of next year, and we may have to look into weekend work even. So, and those lines would have to turn as much as they can. So it would all be full time. And then what it's all about, the site. This wasn't actually the site we had presented the first time. We were looking at a smaller site, but then we were looking at our options with the people from Summit and thinking about what the future may have in stock for us. So in the end, we decided to buy a larger site, and that is what I was talking about. Of course, we have bought that site. That's a done deal. And that was what I was saying. We have some investments that are a change in investment that has been done, that has been decided on. I have some that I will talk about in the end that still need to happen, that still need a final approval. But so we have bought a larger site, also a more challenging site to grade out and to make ready for building, but we had some great adventures, I would call them, together with the people from Summit and Dennis Group. And a bit at a time, we're getting there. And for us, Florence went over smoothly enough to be able to keep us on track there. This is what is already out there. I think there may even already be some more masoned walls out there. But that's the work in progress that we're showing. And you will see some areas in there again. We have a big area there in the middle that is constructed and that still needs, where we still need to determine to choose strategically which product we will make there. So the investment in the base building is there. You see it there. What we have to decide on is if we will fully develop it already at this time, and then where we still have opportunity to make a choice as towards the left, where you see an open wall or no wall actually. And that's actually because we didn't want to put in a concrete precast wall there, because we're hesitating. Are we going to move forward immediately? Do we want to expand immediately? Or do we hold back on that investment for now? So even if we put in a wall, it would be an isolated metal panel wall, keeping our options open. But the good thing would be that we're ready to move forward as quickly as possible. But for that, all the blocks need to fall in the right place. So site plan, as said, we have bought it with the future potential for future expansions up to 10 production lines. And that seems a lot. We're talking about two lines now. That may seem crazy to you. I can tell you that in the last 6 years, Lotus has invested in a new production line for Beskow, one or two every year over the past 6 years, just to be able to follow up with the worldwide growth we're looking at. And as said, today the US is our main growth driver with double-digit volume growth. Timeline that we're looking at has also a bit shifted for the people that would remember the timeline the first time, but we took a lot of time thinking about things, discussing things with our stakeholders. And we're glad we're doing that. That's the kind of company we try to be. If we need to take time, if we need to consider things, we do it. But nevertheless, now we're looking at construction has started in February of this year. We're looking to finish there with the latest finishes in May 2019. Certificate of occupancy may even be a bit sooner. Finish of the equipment installation would be August 2019. That will start, the first steps there will start at the end of this year with the silo installation. And then we're looking at the first commercial production somewhere between September and December. As far as I'm concerned, the sooner the better, but it will depend how well it goes. I think I have three ladies there that would prefer sooner as well, but we'll see how that goes. And then our new investments. So not only a lot in the construction has changed or has evolved since I was here last time, also the reason why I was turning to you for support, for incentives, is different, of course. At that point, we were still trying to make our final decision on location. Mevin was number one on our shortlist. But we still had Guilford County in there. We still had a location in South Carolina. Now we're over here in Alamance County, and we're here for the long run. So that's not gonna change whatever discussions we have tonight. What is important now, as I mentioned, we are looking at adding one or two Beskow lines for the coming years. And there, what I'm trying to do, we have a huge investment now, so already the first investment proposal of $55 million was historically high for an investment in manufacturing within Lotus. So we got the idea that it would be a good idea to basically push through, to invest some more, and basically when they need to decide, when the board of directors need to decide and investing in new lines, I want to be in as good a shape as the plant manager in Belgium is. Because he has his dough making area prepared, he has his warehousing prepared, he has his building there. So for him it's just, what does it cost to put a production line there and create the jobs that come with those production lines. And we're talking over the three shifts of about 15 people per production line that you add there. And that's what I'm trying to do now, and where I'm looking for your support, to basically convince my board to do the last piece of that investment, the last gap that needs to be closed in those $17 million that we would like to invest additionally, to be in the same shape as Lambeke. Which means having, for example, a site that is completely developed, also already the pot for the future building, that we would do that immediately. That means that cost goes away when we have to build a future building. That we have a dough preparation room that already has sufficient capacity, because we've seen that dough making area was a huge cost in our investment. If we have to add that cost for expanding that to the cost of a production line, we will be in worse shape than they are. And then additionally, the installation of high throughput lines and having a plant, a type of building that allows those lines to be in there. It's the longest building that Lotus has constructed so far, also with the idea of being able to do that. So basically, what is already in our favor, if we do it right, if we can finish this project right and go through a good startup, we will have a state-of-the-art greenfield plant. What our board liked enormously was because we did all that study work and we were able to show what all those different cities and counties were offering, they really liked the business-friendly climate of Alamance County, where basically in Europe we have a culture of incentives, and they were like, okay, this is, we expect when we go outside of Europe that it's always less, and they appreciated that they found that same business friendliness in Alamance County. So that's an important element for me towards the board. And that's basically where I'm asking today to help us to create that step to give some additional incentives towards our property tax for me to allow me to convince them to do that full additional $17 million that we want to add to the package. And then basically in the next years, each time that a new line needs to be procured, that I will be able to say, look, remember where we are. We have that business-friendly climate. We are in the market that offers double-digit growth, and we're going to add quality that can only improve that growth, quality, and freshness that we will be adding. So that's why I'm turning to you today and to friendly ask you to give me that last push to be able to phase our board of directors and to convince them to do the full investment of $72 million at this point, basically putting us in the driver's seat for future investments. And then just a reminder what I think we have to bring as Lotus Bakeries to the county and the city. So we have our experience that we're bringing and our culture that goes with this, as we have been in the family hands of the Boons for 8 years. We are going to try to be, and we think we are worldwide so far, an excellent corporate citizen. The company's brand name, I think that's also something. I think every county and city is looking for investors, and maybe just a bit nicer for people to have a food manufacturing company in the backyard to be able to say this delicious cookie is made in my backyard, and also to wake up to the smell of those delicious cookies rather than having some other type of plant in your backyard. And then the long-term employment creation and retention, as said, I'm not adding jobs at this point, but my conviction, I'm really convinced that if we can do this investment right now with your support, I think we're in good shape to have, and I don't even have to say mid long term, I think in short term we will be able to invest in additional production lines, which would add about 15 jobs per line that we're adding there. That's it for me.
All right, gentlemen.
I have some questions.
Go ahead.
So let me just start off by saying over the past 2 years I've become addicted to this coffee. And I buy the two packs, because if I bought the retail, I'd eat the whole package. And this way it causes me to slow down just a little bit.
I have good news for you. We're in the Mebane plant. We will be able to do... We'll have a fresh pack inside that larger pack as well. So if you want to deal with that,
I'll look into that. Could you explain, when you say greenfield, what do you mean by that?
Well, what we have done as Lotus so far, what our model mostly is, we buy new companies, and then mostly they already have kind of a manufacturing plan. So then you try to renovate it, you expand it a bit, but you're always limited by the plant that was there already. While here we looked for a site that offered whatever we needed as far as dimensions went, and we were able to draw the plant around the installations. That's also why I say we're here to leave. We got a question in City of Mabin that said, yeah, if you want to pack up your lines, you're gone. We have a building that will be hard to sell because we're building it and we have designed it for our production installations. So if we have a dough mixer that has a certain size, that has a certain height, we had designed our dough making area around it. So that's the freedom we had if we're talking about greenfield.
So I was thinking that it might relate to sustainability. So could you speak, you mentioned sustainability too, and being environmentally sustainable.
Yes, so. Definitely. We still have to develop our strategy there a bit for the U.S. Especially, we believe, as it's a complete new plant, we have numbers, for example, on wastewater and things like that from our European plants. We hope we will do better here. So what we will actually do, what we have designed now, is that we will haul off all our wastewater, examine it for 2 years, and that may be a bit a higher cost than having a wastewater treatment already. But that way we know exactly what the content of our wastewater will be, and we can design the ideal wastewater treatment property on site. So that kind of things. We will also look into renewable energy, what the opportunities are there. So in our European plans, because in the European model that's what pays off, and honestly that's what the states have been paying for over the years, was to put solar panels up. Here we want to look, do we have to work with wind energy, with solar panels? My experience so far with the North Carolina weather, we may have more benefit from a solar park than from a windmill. But
unfortunately, the state legislature did away with the solar tax credits, the tax credits for solar panels. But I have them on my house, and I believe in them. This is more for Clyde, maybe. The package that we did 2 years ago, I was having a hard time figuring that out from the current revised agreement. And so, or maybe Susan is better to ask, or Brian. We initially agreed that we were going to pay annual payments of roughly $356,000.
That was a one-time payment?
It was just one time. Okay, that's what the clarification that I needed was. So,
an annual payment initially was $273,400.
Well, that's the new one. That's what we would be paying if we go forward.
The original incentive payment was $221,000, right. And the $356,000 was a one-time payment upon the acquisition of the property.
And then what was going to happen after that?
It would be $221,000 annually for 5 years. That was the original.
Okay, so now that we're going to be adding, they're going to be adding $17 million worth of tax base, then it goes, our annual payment would go up to $273,000.
That's correct.
So the way I see it, their total investment becomes $72.7 million, which at 59 cents generates annual tax revenue at almost $429,000. And then we pay them $273,000 to reimburse their capital costs. I mean, is that right?
Yes, they would, in the new arrangement, the amended agreement, it would be $273,400 annually for 5 years.
For 5 years,
yes.
Right. Yeah, but those 5 years would generate roughly $429,000 per year in taxes.
It would be somewhere in that neighborhood.
It may decline because of the depreciation of the fixed equipment.
Is there equipment figured in any of that?
Yes, what we've looked at is, if the amended agreement goes through and Lotus makes the maximum investment that they projected that they could make, the county would be in a better positive cash flow position over the five-year period.
Than originally,
yes. We feel like that would be around $97,000 over the same period that we would net. So the proposed investment by the company from a financial standpoint over the entire incentive period of 5 years is better from a cash flow perspective to the county.
And if I understand the agreement correctly, the value of the investment, if it changes, like if it goes down from year to year because of, say, depreciation, then our liability to them, or our obligation to them, goes down proportionally too. Is that not right?
Yes.
And you described the formula.
It's based on a formula built into the agreement.
Right.
That's correct.
Okay. So cash flow wise, we can't lose.
Well, we don't pay any incentives until the grant is earned.
Right.
And that's the taxes right. are paid and the employees are employed.
That's correct.
And if there's a, if they didn't come up with the employment of the full cadre of employees, then that reduces our obligation to them as well.
Yes, it's right. factored yes. into the formula that we came up with.
I just wanted to be clear about that and make sure people in the room here are clear about
right.
it too.
Yes.
What was Mevin's incentive on this?
I don't have their information in front of me, but I think it was the same.
Waiving fees or something. Did they pass it?
Other questions? Mr. Sutton?
I think everybody knows my position on incentives. Welcome. To start with the second time around.
Thank you,
let me ask you a question. Have you ever heard of Mother Murphy?
Murphy's Law, I have heard of.
Flavoring company in Greensboro.
Oh, okay.
You're not familiar. Yeah, they do flavors for various people all over the world. I didn't know if you were associated with them or not. Again, welcome. I have nothing against your company, obviously. You say we can't lose. I would say we would win bigger if we didn't give incentives, assuming that the company would come anyway and they're here.
Well, that's an assumption.
I hear you, and I'm not going to debate it vehemently. I'm just going to say that I'm opposed to cash incentives. I have been for well over a decade and a half, and our board with different members approved a resolution years ago to ask the state to take the localities out of it. If you want to give it from the state, fine. But, you know, High Point and Greensboro decided not to bid against one another. And in all honesty, it puts us all in a situation where we have to say everybody does it. So we got to do it. I don't believe in following that trend. And in all honesty, I think you have to be bold enough to take a stand. I don't disrespect anybody that votes for incentives. But I've said it repeatedly over the decades that if a banker went to a client and said, bring me your business, I'll give you cash, he would go to prison. But government does it and describes it differently and gives a different excuse. I can't be that way, but I will vote no, but it's nothing personal, and I'm sure you have a great company. And I will say the cookie of the in the guy's mouth with the long hair. Can you go back to that for a moment? I got a comment on this. You know who that looks like? Mick Jagger of the Rolling Stones.
As a kid, right?
If he had done more of that, he would be in better shape today than he is now.
Yeah, you're right about that.
With that, that's Mick Jagger, sure as the world.
Do you have any other questions?
No, I'm good on my questions. I guess we need to open up a public hearing.
We will, after I ask Bill.
You
guys. Bill, do you have any
questions? No questions.
All right, thank you so much for your presentation.
Thank you, Mark.
So the next thing for us to do is to open up a public hearing. If I could have a motion to open a public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to open a public hearing regarding economic incentives for Lotha's Bakeries. All in favor, please say aye.
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 All right, so we're having a public hearing now. Is there anybody on this side of the room who wants to be heard regarding incentives? No? Okay. Is there anybody on this side of the room who wants to be heard? Okay, come on please, forward, sir.
Hey, Brian.
Good evening. Brian Hall with Samet. Thanks for the opportunity to be here. What a great company, right? A great company that has invested seriously in our county. A company that we can all be proud of. A company whose products fly internationally, often.
And they're right. good, too.
They are good.
In fact, I ask for seconds on any plane that I'm on, just to make sure that demand stays up. Right, this company who's international, whose products go all over the world, could locate anywhere in the world that they wanted to locate, right? They've chosen us. They have that same option each time they expand. And there are counties and there are communities all across our country, all across our state, all across this world that would love to have a company like yours, Bart, manufacturing, making their product in their community. We have that opportunity. We have that opportunity to continue to invest in you, in their company, and what they do here. That's important for us. That's important for our company. That's important for our employees. It affects us positively. Our success is predicated on your success, Bart, and how many cookies you can sell. We're here to support them, to support their mission, to support what they want to do. We hope you guys will as well, to continue all of our success here. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anybody else who wants to be heard on this side of the room? And do we have anybody in the overflow room tonight? I want to be sure that I don't miss anybody. All right. If there's no other person who wishes to be heard, if we could have a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and second. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, so now I guess we are at the point where we would discuss if there's any more discussions to be had about whether or not we want to approve this economic incentive package.
Are you ready to entertain a motion?
Sure.
I will make a motion that we accept the recommendation for the incentives.
I'll second that.
So we have a motion and a second to accept the incentives recommendation. Is there any further discussion about that? Hearing none, all in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
No.
Thank you. So, that's that. Okay.
Thank you all very much.
Right. We're glad you chose Alamance County.
I've got a question. What's the expiration on these things?
Normally, I would have brought the product to taste once again. We had some logistical problems with Florence and everything that we could direct in the state on a short term. We directed to Shelter. So you have it coming. As soon as we make it in this county, I will put a display here if the councilman will allow me.
Thank you.
So that you have it at your disposal.
Lovely. Thank you so much. All right. Next on our agenda is a budget amendment from the sheriff.
Good evening, commissioners.
Good evening.
Good evening.
We're very lucky here in the county to have got by the way we got by with on the storm.
That's true. That is so true.
I'm appearing before you tonight to ask for some transfer on two different issues involving federal drug seized money. First, I would like to ask that we be able to transfer $6,480 from our federal drug seized monies to be able to purchase a SailBright unit. This unit is one that you can go into cell phones and extract data that is very, very important in our investigations, et cetera. And with this unit, we'll be able to move quicker on investigations. A lot of our drug investigation, homicide investigations, et cetera. So that's my first request. If y'all want to take them one at a time.
Where was that? I didn't see.
We got a canine handler. That was the first one.
Yes, the very first budget amendment.
Handler training.
9-1, I think it is.
Well, the first one second was $29,000 for
that.
Federal forfeiture for
it's first. A combination.
It's a combination of both of them.
Oh, that's confusing. Okay.
If you want to do it all in one, the second one is we're having to retire one of our canines, and we need another extra canine, and we're asking that $21,280 be transferred from federal drug assets to purchase these canines. And the equipment is needed for them, and also the training of two officers with these canines, which I think all that would be total $29,000.
Yes, the total budget limit is $29,080.
And we can pass that all as one.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Two.
For the canines, $21,280. Two canines.
$2.
Oh, I thought you were saying $2.
$2. I make a motion that we approve it.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve the budget amendment. Is there any further discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Next, we have a budget amendment from the schools capital reserve fund.
Pam, good evening, Commissioners. Before you is a request to transfer $1,542,649.81. What these funds are from is where sales tax, we received in excess of their debt service payment. So what we would be doing is moving these funds into a capital reserve fund that we would use at a later point in time for future capital projects that would be approved by the Board of Commissioners.
And they come to us each time, right?
Yes, sir.
I move approval of that.
Can there be any qualifying here? Do we need to do it to put these funds on hold until the bond referendum goes up or down?
We've incorporated these already into our capital plan.
That was in that financial plan that
yes.
You did.
Yes. So, remind me, so are these part of the $6.8 million that...
These are part of the funds that we will set aside. What these are, Commissioner Sutton, is Article 40 and 42. It's the reserve that is restricted for school service, whether it be for debt service or for future construction. Whenever you have the debt service lower than what the revenue is coming in, general fund cannot hold those dollars. We have to move them over into a dedicated school capital account. And what this will do is we'll move it into the reserve account until they present a project for the Board of Commissioners.
Well, I understand that, but mm-hmm. what I'm saying is in November, they're either going to get $150 million or they're not. So I'm trying to see if we need to protect those funds, at least until we see how that's mm-hmm. that flow is going to go up or down.
Absolutely. These funds, once they're set aside, it would be then the commissioners to approve. So if they were to come before you with a project to utilize some of these funds right. and you were not ready for them to use that those okay. funds, then the board could say no at that time.
I just
time.
Want to make sure there's some checks and balances.
She's got, mm-hmm. you've got to transfer them. That's
correct.
Basically the bottom line.
Okay.
That's
correct. Good. So I made the motion to approve that.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Are there any more questions or further discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you. Anyone opposed? Thank you. All right, Gary Ander.
Who?
Have a budget amendment for stepping up.
Good evening, Commissioners.
Good evening. I'm glad to see you.
Yeah. Thank you. Pleasure to be here. One of our goals with the Stepping Up initiative is to educate folks about mental illness, and that mental illness is simply a medical condition much like diabetes, much like hypertension, that can be managed. And our goal with that is to hope that in destigmatizing mental illness, that more people will seek treatment and there will not be that kind of resistance to seek treatment. If they seek treatment, we won't have as many of those people end up in our detention center. So with that in mind, we have this two-tier plan of doing education. One, providing CIT, crisis intervention training, for first responders and law enforcement. And the second is to provide mental health first aid for county employees, for ABSS employees, other employees in the county. With that in mind, the state, which was actually supplying some funding that was actually through SAMHSA, locally to us to support mental health first aid training, stopped doing that about a year ago. So again, with that in mind, we wanted to continue to support this, and so I wrote a small grant to Impact Alamance to provide support for that. And I think I neglected, I did not have that knowledge that I needed to have your approval before I wrote the grant. So the grant was approved. We got that funding at the Sheriff's Department in June, but it's sitting in some line that we don't have access to until you all approve that so that we can then spend that money on both training and buying mental health first aid manuals. So I guess I'm looking for your approval for that.
After the fact.
Being the co-chair of the Stepping Up initiative, I think it's my duty to make the motion to approve it. So I do
In
that.
This case, the county no funds. So.
Right.
And No.
Second that, sir.
And it's a big help to the county.
Thank you.
And it's going to be mostly for workbooks, as I recall.
It's for training another instructor who we've actually already in training, one of the deputies from our crisis response team from the Sheriff's Department. And then the rest of it will be for manuals.
So I'd just like to comment so everybody knows that Gary and his partner, Linda Allison, are our two part-time, even together, part-time co-coordinators of the Stepping Up Initiative. And they are really responsible for all of this coordination and keeping the meetings going and all the information flowing.
Gary's a good one for that.
And they work under the Sheriff's Department, and it's been
Pardon
a great...
Commissioner?
I said you are a good one for that job.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.
A good organizer.
They do a marvelous job. They really do.
Thank you.
We are lucky to have them.
Linda keeps me in line.
Great. Well, we have a motion and a second to approve the budget amendment. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you so
Thank
much.
You, Commissioner.
Thank you, Gary.
Final budget amendment.
Good evening, Chair Gailey and Commissioners. I'm here this evening to present to you a budget amendment that will allocate funding from the Performance Management Special Project Fund to purchase three patrol cars for the Sheriff's Department. In the budget approved for fiscal year 18-19, we included nine cars in the budget, and we've committed to 12 every year for the Sheriff's Department. This year, in order to balance the budget, we included nine in the fiscal year budget with the understanding that we would ask you to approve an additional three to be purchased from this fund. Current balance of the fund is $88,160.35. The cost of the three vehicles is $87,501. So at the end, if this approval happens, we will have $659.35 left in the Performance Management Special Project Fund. So, if you have any questions, I'll be happy to try to answer. This is in line with our budget plan for the year.
I move approval.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve the performance management spending request to the Sheriff's Department. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you. All right.
I have just two quick items. First of all, I'm very pleased to introduce to you tonight Ms. Tanya Cottle. Tanya is our new planning director, and we're very excited to have her on board. She came to work last week and came to us from Rockingham County, lives here in Alamance County, just really excited about having her. I know the folks from Rockingham County were very unhappy to see her go.
That is true. I still hear about that.
Yeah, so, pleased to have her here this evening with us.
We're glad you're here.
Very
thank
glad.
You.
Welcome.
Welcome.
Great. Thank you for coming tonight. And I just wanted to take just a quick moment, give you a brief update on where we are with our emergency management Hurricane Florence effort. We do have the Graham Recreation Shelter remains open this evening. We have, at last word I had, there were 12 individuals staying in the shelter. We continue to work with the state about the possibility of other folks coming. That's not clear yet. We also remain, our Emergency Operations Center is still open and staffed and will be throughout the night and tomorrow also. And I just wanted to take a moment and recognize the fact that the Alamance County Sheriff's Office did send deputies to New Hanover County and also to Bladen County, and had some interaction with county management from New Hanover County. Very much appreciated, and they just really appreciated the deputies coming to both. And we also sent two telecommunicators to Bladen County. Again, very much appreciated. They're down there now. Deputies are down in New Hanover County now, so please keep all those folks in your prayers. And just, I wanted to say that throughout this event, from start to where we are right now, it's been tremendous cooperation between all agencies involved, DSS Health, our emergency management folks, Recreation and Parks, maintenance coming in, helping us move folks from one shelter to the other. And also, we really appreciate the City of Graham allowing us to access the Graham Rec Center for what could be, and it's hard to tell the city how long that's going to take. And they have just been great, too. So a lot of people working together very well, and we've been very fortunate in Alamance County, and we have great folks working on the emergency, too. So just want to make sure y'all were aware of what we have at this time. And that's all that I have.
Thank you. Good report. Do we have any commissioner comments tonight?
I have one quick one. So my wife Barbara and I stopped by the Graham Recreation Center yesterday just to see how things were going, and the sheriff was there. And we spoke to Gail Barnett, is that her name, from the Red Cross?
That's right.
And she, thank you. And I've known Gail for a long time, but we haven't seen each other in years. But we used to work on the United Way together when she was a bank manager. And Gail just went on and on about how wonderful everybody worked together at that shelter, and that people were coming in from the outside, never seeing that kind of collaboration and cooperation among agencies and departments before. And I just think that's a real testament to the county and to this community. So that was really, really nice to hear.
Got some good people in Alamance County.
Sure do. Really great people. And right. That includes, you know, Susan Osborne and Stacy over at EOC, and just a lot of coordination that was going on, very obvious.
That means a lot. Mm-hmm. Means a lot.
Anybody else have anything to say? Okay. If not, then we'll be adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners occur on the first and third Monday of every month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month occurs at 9 a.m. and the second meeting occurs at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on LocalGov TV. Please go to www.localgovtvnc.com for more information about this schedule and to see more videos produced by your local governments. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com or at our YouTube channel. Technical questions regarding this meeting's broadcast or production may be sent to our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. This address is for technical questions only. Comments and questions about the content of the meeting may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. There, you can click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes and agendas of commissioner meetings, and find other information about the county commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.